On the front line between East and West, where one Germany is divided from the other, soldiers of the Warsaw Pact approach a British army patrol.
So Hunt has got a phone in his pocket now, see?
The radio phone.
Yeah, but it's not got no lead going to it. It must be a remote somewhere. Plug in.
A confrontation with cameras. Comic, but depressing. A reminder that the price of peace has been a long, cold war.
He's got something on his shoulder.
Britain is crucial to NATO, but the British role in the Western Alliance is under fire as never before. The issue is nuclear weapons.
We are against the present strategy, which we don't think makes any sense. Of course, we are part of NATO. We are not contracting out of NATO, and we're going to stay in NATO. We want to convince NATO to change that strategy.
The challenge from the Labour Party in Britain alarms NATO at the highest level.
Oh, I think it could lead to the unravelling of the alliance.
Despite the grim fact of this frontier, it's hard to imagine the circumstances in which the desolate silence of this plain would be suddenly pierced by hundreds and thousands of Russian tanks racing across into the west, accompanied by an airborne armada of fighters and bombers. The confusion, the fury, and the carnage of a battle which would in fact be the start of World War III. But it's precisely that prospect, that worst-case scenario, as it is called, for which NATO plans.
The British Army patrols along a silent but hostile border. The 9th, 12th Lancers form the advance guard of the British Army of the Rhine, stationed in Germany in defence not only of Europe, but of Britain itself. For this patrol, the future of NATO is a rather more than passing concern. If the unthinkable should ever happen, then this front line would at once become part of a vast battlefield on which thousands upon thousands of soldiers would perish. The unthinkable is never far from the NATO mind. On the basis of intelligence reports and close study of Soviet strategy, NATO planners have identified three potential routes for an invasion by the Warsaw Pact. In ground war, the lie of the land is an absolute dictator. So what's called the Hof Corridor could be one route for a blitzkrieg. Further to the northwest, there is another potential invasion point at the Fulda Gap. However, the most vulnerable point of all is perhaps the North German plain, territory that's not vacant, but occupied right up to the border by a concentration of villages and towns like Wolfenbüttel. The journey by Soviet tank from the border to the centre of the ancient town of Wolfenbüttel would take perhaps 30 minutes. As inhabitants of the potential killing ground, the citizens of Wolfenbüttel incline to the view that the survival of the NATO alliance is for them a matter of life and death.
Was sollen wir ohne NATO? Gegen diese Aufrüstung, die wir im Osten haben, können wir nicht überleben in Freiheit und Frieden. Die garantiert unsere Freiheit und Frieden. Also nicht ohne NATO.
It's 3 days until the German electorate go to the polls. As always, defense is an issue.
Dürfen wir Ihnen was mitgeben, einen Stift?
The CDU, the Conservatives, who've been in power for the last 4 years, are unequivocal in support of NATO's present strategy. In opposition, the Social Democrats, the SPD, have struggled to unite around a policy designed to challenge NATO's nuclear philosophy without losing votes. They campaign for the removal of every nuclear missile from all German soil, east and west. Not exactly extreme, but enough to place their prospect of power in jeopardy.
For we have now the hot time.
For the British politician Denzel Davis, the SPD campaign is of the greatest interest. As the Shadow Secretary of Defense, facing an election in which the issue of NATO and nuclear weapons could make or break his party, he's in great need of European allies.
Well, your policy isn't very different from ours when it comes to the defense of this area. I've driven down from Hanover through Brunswick here, and it seems to me inconceivable that anybody can fight a nuclear war in this part of Germany.
Just outside Wolfenbüttel, the 9th 12th Lancers are on exercise in a forest a few miles from the border. They form part of a high-speed reconnaissance unit. On the outbreak of war, these men would report the direction and scale of the Warsaw Pact onslaught, information which would be dispatched at once to every NATO capital while the world went on nuclear alert. This routine rehearsal plays a small but crucial part in NATO's strategy of deterrence. A joint operation between a detachment of the 9th 12th Lancers and a German reconnaissance unit is designed to promote cooperation between different members of the same alliance. In NATO's military jargon, your deterrence strategy is more credible if your adversary believes what you say. Hence, in an alliance of many nations, the need to speak with one voice according to one plan.
Right. We've been up, there. And we've seen the bridge. Which is just here.
Yeah.
And we think there's a minefield. Just on the edge.
The avowed purpose of deterrence is to ensure that by playing war games like this, you will never need to fight in earnest.
Right. Okay. I wish you good luck.
Yeah, thanks. Good luck.
In peacetime on the German front, NATO deploys the combined forces of five nations. Facing the Hof Corridor and the Fulda Gap is the Central Army Group CENTAG. This comprises some 300,000 American troops, flanked on either side by the German army. The North German plain is garrisoned by the Northern Army Group, NORTHAG. Four nations, the Dutch, the Belgians, the Germans again, and the 55,000 men of the British Army of the Rhine. At their headquarters, on the outskirts of Wolfenbüttel, which once accommodated airmen of Hitler's Luftwaffe, the 9th 12th Lancers occupy a little bit of Britain on German soil. Throughout the NORTHAG sector, there are scores of similar garrisons and bases. They form part of a commitment to NATO, which altogether consumes almost 95% of Britain's defence budget, which is now over £18,000 a year.
Guard, Commander! Take post!
All right, left wheel, quick, march!
For over 35 years, Britain has been instrumental in formulating NATO strategy. That strategy is now under challenge as never before.
The strategy in which these troops would be directly involved is called flexible response. That phrase sounds bland enough, but it conceals or embraces a doctrine that is now highly contentious, because flexible response involves nuclear weapons, and in particular, the need and will to use nuclear weapons first.
For the Labour Party, the strategy of flexible response is provocative folly, the threat to use nuclear weapons an ominous absurdity.
Well, it's a nonsense because we don't think they can be used or should be used. We're actually destroying this territory, which we are intending and wishing to defend. We're actually destroying the territory with nuclear weapons. What we are saying is if some of this territory is lost, and lost temporarily, we are still going to fight a conventional war. We are not going to destroy your towns and your cities with nuclear bombs and nuclear shells. We will have the defense in depth so that, in fact, we can regain that territory and not lose more territory. The problem with the present strategy is that if a few kilometers are lost, then we go nuclear. Now, that doesn't make any sense.
The demand that NATO should abandon nuclear weapons in Europe dismays almost every government in the Western Alliance. NATO's military commanders are perplexed and alarmed. However, at the headquarters of the British Army of the Rhine, NORTHAG's commander-in-chief, General Sir Martin Farndale, is forbidden to comment in public about the military implications of losing NATO's nuclear strategy, as the issue is so politically explosive. The German army, however, is slightly less reticent.
You are aware that nuclear forces are really the backbone of deterrence. Only nuclear forces confront an aggressor with an unbearable and incalculable risk.
Can you personally imagine what a battlefield would be like once it had gone nuclear?
No, I could not. But don't forget, we don't have all these weapons to fight a war. They are here to prevent a war, and so far they have done that for at least 35 years.
Why do you think so many members of NATO make it clear in one way or another that they think the adoption of your policy would cause mayhem, dissent, and threaten the very survival of NATO?
Because I think if one reads the history of strategy, quite often when a new idea is put forward, and quite naturally, especially among military people, because we're all perhaps conservative with a small c, and military people particularly so, they tend to be wedded to the strategy of the past.
Don't you think that people like General Farndale, the commander of the British Army of the Rhine, would find that odd, if not somewhat offensive?
Well, I don't mean it to be offensive to General Farndale, who is an excellent commander, or anybody else, but I think if one does look at history, there is always a tendency for the professional, perhaps in whatever field, not necessarily military, to be wedded to his profession, to what he has learnt when he was learning. That's always been the danger, and there's a very real danger in terms of military strategy.
Delta Alpha.
Under a Labour government, these RAF pilots in Germany would be in receipt of new orders. Their mission at the moment would be to strike deep into enemy territory in tornado jets that might be armed with nuclear weapons. A Labour government would forbid any such weapons to be carried on British tornadoes.
Clear her, Derek.
Clear.
Labour believes that the threat to strike deep is provocative and dangerous. A Labour government would urge NATO to adopt a defence strategy based exclusively on conventional weapons. But exactly what strategy and at what price is not yet clear. And regardless of Labour's opinion, NATO in wartime could simply send other tornadoes from other nations. They would fulfil the same mission and might even leave from the same base.
Again, it makes no military sense. I think we are talking the military sense. Use them by all means with conventional weapons. But to think that we can bomb, when you talk about enemy territory, we're talking about the Germany on the other side of this particular border. We're talking about Poland. We're talking about countries, in fact, we want closer ties with. And yet we're talking about dropping hydrogen bombs on those countries. It makes no military sense. And after Chernobyl, we can see what happens with radiation. You know, it blows back to your own troops. Again, it destroys your own forces as much as the enemy forces.
For that reason, too, a Labour government would try to spike some of the plans for NATO's big guns, the battlefield nuclear weapons.
Hold on, son! Hold.
Britain's howitzers can fire a shell with pinpoint accuracy over a distance of almost 15 miles. With conventional explosive, a howitzer blasts a crater 60 meters in radius. With a nuclear shell, it could destroy a city the size of Hiroshima. Labour is not alone in rejecting such nuclear weapons. Indeed, the entire strategy of flexible response has been under fire from a distinguished range of ex-generals and diplomats. Yet in one fundamental respect, Labour is almost entirely isolated.
It's one thing to argue that the threat to use this as a nuclear weapon is incredible, suicidal, or immoral. It would be quite another, at least from the NATO perspective, if Britain were ever to say, if you do use this as a nuclear weapon, you do it without us.
Unilateralism on the battlefield is a challenge to the strategy of deterrence. In peace, each country has its own patch and its own command. But in war, every member of the alliance, every soldier, is required to be obedient not to a nation, but to NATO. So, British may serve under Dutch, Dutch under Americans, Americans under Germans, and Germans under British, all of them under one commander-in-chief.
My commander, my NATO commander, is the British General Sir Martin Farndale. If I ask for air support in peacetime for exercises or in war, then I don't know what nation is going to provide that air support. Could be Belgium or the Netherlands or the United States or the United Kingdom. Now, to make that integration work, I think we have to constantly work on agreed operational procedures. We have to exchange soldiers and whole units. We have to train and to exercise together, and we have to promote standardization, equipment and technology.
What then happens if one nation says, we are not going to be integrated into the flexible response strategy, we will not handle these battlefield nuclear weapons, for example?
I think it would weaken the cohesion of NATO considerably and make perhaps deterrence weaker.
All we are saying is, as far as Britain is concerned, we see no sense in our political leaders ever agreeing to use those weapons. What an American president will do, I don't know, frankly. I think he would agonize as well for a very long time, but that's another question.
I must press this point. If the American president decides, with the agreement of the other NATO allies, that the time had come to use nuclear weapons, battlefield nuclear weapons, you are saying we, the Labour government, would tell our troops, tell our commanders, sorry, you may not use them.
Well, we would say we would not call upon those American weapons for our troops. The Americans might use them, but if they were to use them, frankly, it'd be a different kind of war. I mean, it would not be a war in the normal sense. And our case is that then that would destroy our troops and the troops of the United States and the Federal Republic.
And you would instruct British commanders not to be party to their use?
Well, this of course, is way down the road, because we think and believe that we can change the strategy.
But if you don't, if you can't?
If we can't at the end of the day, we reserve our sovereign political right to say we will not call for those weapons.
Why would it then damage the cohesion if, say, the British said, sorry, we're not going to handle?
It could damage the cohesion because, in my view, NATO is a risk-sharing community. We all share the same risk, and I think that is the cornerstone of the cohesion.
A British Labour Party in search of allies has alighted upon the German SPD, detecting among the Social Democrats a similar aversion to nuclear weapons. But the SPD leader, Johannes Rau, is in desperate need of votes from an electorate which displays little enthusiasm for radical change. To promote the cause of unilateralism in the Germany of 1987 is to court political suicide. Your strategy involves the removal of nuclear weapons on this side of Europe within NATO.
On both sides.
Would you be prepared in government to have any removal of weapons without a deal with the Warsaw Pact?
No, we need a deal, because there are two parts, and we have to see that the equality of weapons can be reached.
What then is your view of the Labour Party policy, which is to unilaterally remove nuclear weapons from Europe?
Great Britain is in another situation than the Federal Republic, because we are on the border to the Eastern Bloc, and Great Britain has another position. And Neil Kinnock and his friends make some proposals for the discussion within NATO, and I think these proposals are as important as other views from my French friends or from our German party, and we have to discuss it in NATO.
In Wolfenbüttel, the issue is simple. If you live at the front, then your only alternative is peace. If deterrence fails, your world collapses. In much of Germany, the proposal that NATO should unilaterally abandon nuclear weapons stirs powerful feelings.
Für mich sein, als wenn man jemand, als wenn man 1949 Berlin im Stich gelassen hätte mit der Luftbrücke. Ja. Genauso empfinde, würde ich das empfinden.
Ja.
Wir haben durch die Nuklearwaffen immerhin 41 Jahre keinen Krieg gehabt in Europa. Das ist die längste Zeit, wo wir im Frieden leben.
NATO is therefore willing to launch an official attack of the sharpest kind against the policies advocated by the Shadow Minister of Defense.
If he thinks that the alliance as a whole can do without nuclear weapons while the Soviet Union and the Warsaw Pact have them, that's personally not a situation which I, as Secretary General of NATO, or as a citizen of Western Europe, would regard with much favor or feel that I was very secure. If he means, is it all right for other people to have the nuclear weapons while we don't, I'm not sure that I find that a very moral position, but then that's not for me as Secretary General to make a judgment about that.
NATO is not a federal institution. NATO is not the common market, if you like. NATO is a collection of sovereign states, and we all play our part. And our case is that those weapons certainly don't protect our soldiers, because they would be the first to be destroyed if they were used. And they don't protect the German people, and we are here to help to protect them as well, and to protect Western Europe.
I think Britain has been, and I'm not saying this because I'm British particularly, but I think we've been in a rather special position because we've been a nuclear power, and we've also had, as a founder member of NATO, and we've had the American bases in Britain. We've been in a very special position. I think that if the British government decided to go non-nuclear with all the consequences that I've been talking about, it would have a very considerable effect upon the other governments of Northern Europe, and I don't know what would happen.
But you do believe it could lead to the unravelling of flexible response to the entire strategy?
Oh, I think it could lead to the unravelling of the alliance.
There is hardly a greater issue than the preservation of peace in Europe. At the border, the state of alert has been so low for so long that the possibility of war seems utterly remote, even to the patrol at the front. Which does not mean that peace is eternal. This knowledge is at the very core of the nuclear debate. Does NATO's strategy secure the peace or put Europe at risk? Does it deter or provoke? Meanwhile, on the nuclear front line, all is quiet.